Well, I'm David Chapman. I'm with former Dallas Cowboy great John Niland. John played guard for the
former great? Really?
You're still great.
I'm no great. I'm not great.
He played
guard. Start all over. That was a terrible interview. I'm not great.
He was the guard for the Dallas Cowboys in the 60s and 70s. Actually, noted as one of the best point guards in his era in the 60s and 70s. And we're here to talk about John and his playing career with the Dallas Cowboys and about his faith and other subjects. Okay, the first question I want to ask you, you were drafted in 1966, first round, number five, fifth selection. You were the first lineman in franchise history to be drafted by the Cowboys. On that day, when you were being drafted, were you by the telephone? Were you spending time with your family? What were you going through?
Actually, I was in Iowa at the time, and I got word through a phone call that they drafted me, and it turned out that I called my parents up, you know, and I said, "Hey, Dad, sell the car. We're getting you a brand new car." Look at houses there in Amityville. I grew up in Amityville, Long Island, New York, the Amble Horror town. Anyway, I told Dad, I said, you know, start looking around. I want to be able to buy you a new house. And I took my bonus money. I went back to Amityville and bought him a new house, a new car. I said, "What kind of car do you want?" He goes, "Let me get back to you." Called me back the next day. Said, "I want a Nash Rambler." A Nash Rambler?
Wow.
I thought maybe a Cadillac or something there. At least a Ford. Man. A Nash Rambler. What's so good? Well, it happens to be, has reverberation radio that preceded stereo.
Right.
It has power windows, air conditioning. And the only one in the whole entire Long Island area was canary yellow.
Wow.
Canary yellow Nash Rambler. So I bought it. It was $5,000, a brand new car. And a nice. Found them a house there, so I was kind of excited about giving back to my parents what they gave me, because I was adopted.
Right.
And they were very, very good to me, and certainly we didn't have a lot of money. We were kind of a poor family, but obviously I grew up and I didn't starve, and they furnished everything I needed.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Giving back to your family. I mean, that's, players would think about that. Rice first thing off their mind is to give.
Well, I think they think about it. You know, I think that most kids that would come up in the way I did, you know, and especially being adopted. I think it's obviously a thing you have to be grateful for, and at the same time, why not give back, you know? And
right.
At that point in my life, I didn't need money, and I was just a punk kid coming out of University of Iowa, and I felt that at least I could give something back to say thank you in some
right.
way.
I'm sure it meant a lot to them, too.
Yeah, they did. They were excited about it, and obviously my mother, she'd go shopping with my dad. Now, he had a Nash Rambler, brand new. He'd drive it around Dallas, drive around New York, and he would pull into like a Tom Thumb and park right there.
Right.
She'd have to walk all the way over to the parking lot to the store, because he wanted no dents in his car.
Right.
And she'd have to walk all the way back with the groceries, and they'd load them up, and he'd drive her home. He had that car for like 5 or 6 years. It was brand new. He washed it almost every day. He was a night watchman. He was a Pinkerton night watchman on job sites,
wow.
construction sites. And so that job was keeping busy at night, so he'd get out there, and aside from watching the tools, he'd wash his car every night. So that car had a beautiful, was beautifully taken care of.
Yes,
after 5 years, I moved him to Texas, and then for a different reason, and that was an interesting story, because they said, "Well, we're going to sell the car." "No, I want that car." That was a five-year car. That was a classic by then. They sold it to my uncle for like $500. I could have sold it.
So yeah, you had a time in it though.
Yeah, I mean it was a time of my life where you could, all of a sudden you have money and you say, "Dad, can you hear that noise? I'm sorry.
I heard a beep."
That's my hearing aid.
Oh, pretty good.
It's very faint.
Yeah, let me turn it down a little bit.
No, it's very faint.
So anyway, it turns out that one night when I came to the realization I had some money for a change, I went to my dad and mom. I said, "Yeah, I'm going to take care of you." And so buying them a house and buying them a car, and then finally I moved them to Texas primarily to witness them.
Right.
Because I didn't think either one of them were saved. And it turned out that my mother, I had witnessed to her, and she called me up one day. She said, "Well," she's 5'2", little lady, she said, "Well, I did it." "What'd you do, Mom?" She said, "I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I turned the sound up on the TV so Pop could hear it on the porch. It's Billy Graham right now talking about it."
All right. Awesome.
Okay, Mom. Good job.
That is awesome.
So that was the experience with my family. So taking that bonus money, taking care of them, being able to provide for them in the latter years of their life, and then eventually moving to Texas, primarily to witness to them. Right. And they moved them out here to Carrollton, and they lived here, and they both passed away, unfortunately, about 5 or 6 years later.
I'm sorry to hear that.
They were in their 50s when they adopted me, and so therefore, you know, they were quite old, so it turned out, you know, I was very blessed to have them as parents.
Wow, so they got to see your playing career. They got to watch you play.
They did get to watch me play. In fact, the one funny story I'll tell you is we played the New York Giants, and the New York Giants, of course, big New York City, and we get off the bus at Yankee Stadium, which was where we played. Right. And my mother's 5'2", and she runs up to Tex Schramm. Mr. Schramm, you know my son, Johnny Niland, he's on the bus somewhere. Is he on the bus out there? Oh my God! My mother's telling him, oh, Johnny Niland, that's my son. He plays for your team. And Tex Schramm was very gracious. Oh yeah, he's on the bus. He said, no problem. So anyway,
that's nice. My mom. That's nice. So yourself, you were pretty excited to be drafted by the Cowboys.
Well, I didn't know any better. You know, I'd never been anywhere. I went to Iowa, that's obvious, but up until the time I got drafted by the Cowboys, I had never been anywhere else in the country. And so consequently, we did visit other teams, other colleges, but we played them. But I had not really had a chance to do anything, and so consequently, when I had money to be able to afford a car and go around different places, I looked at Texas, and I thought you were just John Wayne atmosphere down here, you know. They're still riding horses and, you know, parking out in front of the house and stuff like that. And I was pleasantly surprised. It's a beautiful area, and it certainly was good to me. Being a cowboy in the Dallas town was a real blessing because of the simple fact that we were the celebrities of town.
Right.
And the fans just opened up to us. I mean, they were very much... The fans here are different than fans in New York.
Right.
Fans in New York, they'll shoot you. You know?
You
shouldn't say that. But, you know, they're real fans here. And consequently, I loved living here because they were good to me in the off-season. I got a couple of jobs through football, and, you know, I was able to parlay some of that communication and contact with other people that gave me a career and worked at different ventures when I was in the off-season.
Right.
So I was very blessed here in Dallas. It's a great town.
And the players back then, they were pretty approachable by their fans. You could talk with them and carry constant conversations with them, and which is different from today.
Yeah, it is. I have different feelings today than the day I got hired by the Cowboys in the sense of the game. You know, I like what Thomas Jefferson said. He said, games played with the ball and things of that sort stamp no character in the minds of men. Mm. Games played with a ball and things of that sort does not stamp character in the minds of men. And I heard that years ago, and I kind of understand it today. I don't think there's anything normal about six guys up front, the linemen, beating each other up. That's not normal.
Right.
That's not, but that's the game, you know, and I can see, you know, playing hand and catching a great pass and throwing a great ball and doing a great run, stuff like that. That's artistic. A lot of that is very motion exciting, if you want to say it that way. And I watched the game today, and that's really kind of enjoyable to watch. But as far as the guys up front, we're just killing each other. We're just kind of beating up on each other, and it's really... I don't think it stands much character in the minds of men.
Right.
And because offensive linemen, I think, control the game and win the game for you, but defensive linemen control the championship.
Right.
They win the championships for you. So from my standpoint, you know, I don't think there's much to learn from football. I mean, the characterization that we're all in love with and watch every Sunday, you know, it's great to watch. It's exciting. But really, the telecast itself, I think it's kind of boring, except for the few instant replays. Come on back, let's talk about them again. Let's run them again. Let's see the tiptoes up on the sideline. Oh yeah, he was in bounds. That makes it kind of exciting. But to me, the game really is, hate to say it, boring.
Boring? And other than if there wasn't any great plays to be played and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, quite frankly, I think it's boring. But I think also the characterization of linemen in particular, we're paid to beat the crap out of you.
Right.
And that's your job. And you know, we want to kill you. There was a great author at the time. I say great. I mean, he wrote a book called Psycho-Cybernetics. And he was a think tank sort of guy by Maxwell Maltz. I think he was a communist, but I don't know. He wrote a book that said, basically, think through the block. You've already made the block.
Right.
You've already knocked the guy right on his butt, and you're standing over him, and you're stomping on him, and you just... clear him out of the path and go to the next guy. You know, that kind of worked for me because I wasn't particularly big. Mm-hmm. I was pretty strong, but I really wanted to pound. pound a guy. I wanted to pound a guy. I wanted to pound a guy. I just wanted to beat that guy up. And eventually I did it. And for the most part, I was successful at it to a degree. I mean, I obviously got beat myself from time to time.
Right.
But certainly I was very good at just constantly putting my head and shoulders into the chest of that guy and just beat the poop out of him if I could do it. And I don't know if that's really healthy. I'm not sure that's really valuable. I understand competition. I understand going after the guy. I understand the fortitude that you have and the constant coming back. And you're going to have mistakes. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to lose. Come on back and do it again. That I understand. But the physiology of the game of beating up each other in the pit, I don't think that stands much character in the minds of men.
I understand that. But at the same time, it's you against that guy across the line. You got to give, you got to have confidence to beat that guy.
True.
Play after play after play. So there's a little pride in that. And when you play, and I see the violence of the game. I can see where you're actually saying, well, why are we doing this? Other than putting points on the board and winning a game.
I think it's stupid. I really think it's stupid. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love the game. I love watching it like everybody else. It's a great catch. And, he tippy toes out of the sidelines. Oh, he's in bounds, We got instant replay. That's a big play. That's a big important play in the last week when they played. The point being is also that makes it a little more technically accurate, which even gives it another dimension of excitement.
Right.
But as far as the game of hitting each other, we hit each other 60, 70 times a game. For what?
Right. I got a question. Your second year with the Cowboys, you played in the Ice Bowl, 1967 championship game against the Packers. Ice Bowl, the coldest game in NFL history.
At that time it was. I went against a guy named Henry Jordan. Fortunately, Henry Jordan was my size, so the two of us were like two guys out on skates. The ground was frozen. We couldn't really get into the ground, and we just kind of pushed each other around like a hockey puck. We kind of gone with the flow. But the game was played. It shouldn't have been played. I think it should have been held off for a day or so, maybe. Because the ground was really nice and thawed out on Saturday when we worked out practice. And we had good footing, good track. We had a great game plan. We get there on Sunday, and it's totally frozen. I mean, we went from a solid, for a nice porous ground where we could run to a solid ice beat. And the fans got cheated as far as I'm concerned. I mean, it's a game you'll always talk about and discuss. But we played poorly. They played poorly. I think the fans got shortchanged, except for the Green Bay fans. They won. Go figure. But, the game really was a poor game. And I think, I think the fans got cheated. But it'd been a much better game had we had good turf. But we didn't.
Right.
We lost.
What were your thoughts during that game? I mean,
freezing.
I mean, you wanted this game to get over with. You wanted the time to stop.
Well, as a lineman, I never really wore a lot of stuff under my shoulder pads. I'd wear a t-shirt.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a t-shirt under my shoulder pads, under my jersey, and it's 20 below zero. It's almost like, what was I thinking? But if I put any more clothing on, I felt kind of restricted.
Right.
So I wanted to be able to at least move. Unfortunately, you couldn't move because your skates, the ice, it just made it impossible.
Right.
So, it's a game we'll always remember, we'll always talk about, and we lost. So what are you going to do?
Did you feel after the game, did you have any frostbite? Were your feet numb? Were your fingers numb? How did you stay on the sideline? How did you stay warm?
Well, we did come to the sideline. We tore a big old coat over us, and we tried to keep our hands somewhat thawed out. But your fingers get thawed, and the fingers and the toes will freeze. And those are the things that went on my head. My feet were just frozen, and my fingers were literally, couldn't feel them. And so you were just kind of like, it was like bumper pool out there. You play bumper pool?
Right.
And that's all it was. We just like a pinball. We were just bouncing up against each other, and really nothing was significant in the way of the performance was terrible.
Right, and you really couldn't get comfortable after
no,
to do your thing.
Not at all.
Wow. I can imagine playing in that cold weather like that. I know it was, you guys were mentally tough to play that game, and in and out.
No, we weren't. We were freezing our butts off.
You had to play, though. You had to get out there and do it, so you had to.
Yeah, we got a paycheck.
Some kind of mindset.
That was a paycheck attached to that game. You certainly wanted to go out and get paid.
Okay, I got another question. You played with quarterbacks Don Meredith, Craig Morton, Roger Staubach, and as a lineman, because I know Meredith played for a few years, and then you went to Morton, Morton, then you went to Staubach, came in. And then you had the rotating quarterbacks with Staubach and Morton going out on every play.
Mm-hmm.
As a lineman, He goes, each quarterback plays different.
Right.
Their cadence are different, their color plays different, what have you. What's the toughest thing for a lineman to adjust to per quarterback that come in and would play in the game?
Well, I think to get the cadence down to the style of his verbiage, you know. I mean, Roger would say 4-3 set, and Roger might say 4-3 set, you know, and that was kind of a contact verbal message that we're in a 4-3 defense, and get set, meaning we get up, we sit down, if you remember that.
Right.
Stand up, get back up. So it was more of learning the cadence of the verbiage, not so much that the play, the plays were the same, from quarterback to quarterback. It was better to block for Roger than Alda, because Roger would, at least if we got beat up, our alignment got past us, Roger would run around and not get caught.
Right.
Where Craig would, Don definitely got caught. Morton seemed to run around pretty good. You know, the whole idea, you want someone who can get out of that pocket or is forced out of the pocket, can usually scramble and not get tackled beyond the line of scrimmage. And that's what Roger did. He kind of opened up the game for us, made it easier to block for him, quite frankly. So what the guy's going to stay in the pocket was supposed to.
Right.
Stay in the pocket. And that way you get the pass out there, a step up into the pocket, and not get hurt. But they get beat up too.
Right.
And so consequently, that was the only difference I saw. Is Roger would run around and gave us a little more time to throw the ball.
Okay, well, you brought up the point when the lineman raised up and sat down.
Mm.
That was Tom Landry brought that in effect for the, I guess for the back, 20-yard set, or whoever you had, Calvin Hill back there.
Yeah.
When you got up, they would move to a different position and go back down. Mm. As the game went on, was that tough on you guys?
No, the theory, of course, was if you got guys that are 6'5" standing up in front of you and your defensive back at 5'8", or 6 foot, whatever, you got these 11, 12 guys standing up, you can't see what the backs are doing.
Right.
And so you camouflage it. And gives you only a few seconds to make adjustments, especially if you were making changes on your defense or whatnot. So by the time we were back in our stance, ready to take off, that was the shortness of the time that it gave you to basically run that game plan. And this way you kind of camouflage the offense.
Right, right.
But they catch up eventually. I mean, they caught up real fast because the computers.
Right.
The computers got into the game and everything became a statistic at that point. Right. So it really kind of lost its effectiveness, and that's why you don't see it today. The shotgun you still have. We had the shotgun quite often.
Right.
And most every team now uses the shotgun. So Landry really, I think he was ahead of his time.
Right.
And was the first, I think he was the first coach to use the computer to statistically determine what you're doing as an offense that we played against or defense played against.
Wow.
And by throwing all those numbers into the hat and shaking it up and outspits the tendencies of,
right,
of your defense. That's a great advantage.
Yeah.
So that did work. But giving them less time to react and adjust, the whole idea behind that standing up and standing down was just to confuse the defense.
Right. And myself, as a fan, I thought it was pretty cool. I mean, nobody else did it in the league. And the Dallas Cowboys, you know, they brought
TV. They still do it. Yes.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, they'll do it on the last play of the game or something.
Yeah.
I guess that's the, I don't know why they do it. I guess it's a pay some respects to Landry. I don't know.
Yeah, but I loved it back then. I think it was pretty cool.
But the current team does too.
Right. Oh, I don't know. I didn't really kind of realize that.
Yeah, the current team did it in one of the games, I think. And I think they did it as a ceremony to Landry.
Right.
I'm not sure which game it was, but I think I heard it. I really didn't see it. But I heard it.
Right. That's awesome. We're gonna take a break for just a moment, and we'll be back.
Yeah.
Okay, we're back with John Niland, Dallas Cowboy guard. I want to talk to you about your lineman that you played next to, Tony Lisco, the relationship you guys had on the field. I know on certain plays, you got plays with certain players that are more aggressive on different areas, and you need to help him or if he needed to help you on certain defenses that were being played. What was, kind of talk about the relationship you guys had when you played games.
Well, there was communication in the line, although it wasn't that obvious because you didn't want the defense to catch on. But there would be certain things said at the line or going up to the line. We'd have an active color, let's say, and it was blue. And blue was the active color, and if I said blue, that would change the play at the line of scrimmage because of the defense they showed. And also we'd say blue-green, which means, what's the snap count? I forgot. and that happens too, because by the time you hug them, get up to the line of scrimmage, that's a whole 5 seconds. I forgot the snap. blue-green, 4. That meant it was on 4. So, you know, it's the communication, you always know what each other's going to do, and you know what the strength is of the center, and you know the strength of the tackle. We used to have to catch the game, we call it. That's where a tackle would slant across, and the end would slant back across the other way, and they game you in between, trying to get you out of sync so they would get past and sock the quarterback, of course. But we were pretty good about picking up those defenses. I think the thing about our defense, and again, take this for what it's worth, we had some smart guys up there. I mean, Blaine Nye, Stanford, John Fitchell, Boston College, me from Iowa, I don't know how I got in there. You know, I mean, we had some really smart, and we were given aptitude tests. I remember having aptitude tests given to us quite often during my career. And I would think, again, this is my opinion, it seemed to me like Landry did keep the smarter players that could adjust and keep the aptitude going in the sense of understanding that in a conflict or in an emergency situation, you got to have guys that can really respond.
Right.
And that's what we did well. We Roger could call an audible, and fortunately we responded pretty well. We could run the play. And that was smart coaching, quite frankly.
Right.
So, you know, if we were smarter players, I think Landry did that on purpose. And if you were stupid, they put you on defense. No, I'm just
kidding. Because all they do is just run, right? Run.
I didn't say that, Bob Lilly.
Speaking of Bob Lilly, that's you. You had to practice against Bob Lilly every day.
Yeah.
Every day, and
he made me what I was. I mean, Bob Lilly, I have to credit with making me as good as I was. If I have any talent, or had any talent and any recognition from the people, it's because of Bob Lilly every day of practice wearing me out and getting me going and not letting me slough off, you know.
Right.
Sometimes we used to have what we call full potatoes. Full potatoes meant we're going full speed. And that would be, you'd hear us often.
Right.
Bob would say, full potatoes, you know. In other words, he wanted to go full speed.
Right.
And not that he's going to kill you. He's not going to try to hurt your legs or anything, because that's not the purpose of it. The purpose of it is to get real time, real speed down in the performance of your game to get ready for Sunday. You just wanted to go full potatoes.
Right.
He wanted to go full potatoes all the time. and it made me more confident knowing if I could block Bob Lilly, I knew I could block Alan Page, I could block Joe Green. You know, I just had the confidence that almost anybody that I played against wasn't nearly as good as Bob Lilly.
Right.
And so for that reason, I was able to adjust my game, and I'm grateful for it. Yeah.
Well, you know, and it's got to go on the other side, too. Bob Lilly was going against the best, too.
Well, I'd like to think that, yeah.
Niland. So, you know, what he couldn't use on you, he could probably use on other players.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
I mean,
he was quick, fast, very, very creative with his arm movements and whatnot. And he would run around you pretty good.
Dude, tell me about the Dallas Cowboys as a team as a whole. Were you guys close? Were you guys, some teams' offense or coaches are training the offense to hate the defense, and defense to hate the offense, because when you go to play another team, you've got to have that angry mentality anyways to play. But at the same time, you've got to have some camaraderie. I mean, your team has got to be close.
Yeah, we had both. I think we had the competitiveness. When we practiced every day, I was on Wednesday, we would practice offense. On Thursday, we practiced defense, full potatoes. Mm-hmm. Which meant that we were practicing their plays that they were going to face that week. We would mimic the team we were playing, their offense. So we would get out there and run their plays during practice. And so they prepared themselves very well. We prepared ourselves well, too. On Wednesday, we'd run all the offensive plays against the defenses we were anticipating. Mm-hmm. So consequently, they would run the defenses and prepare us. Landry had it down to a science. I mean, he really had his computer system involved. He had great coaches. He had a great mind for the game. He was a good tactician, but he had great support from his assistant coaches as well, who put a lot of energy and effort into making us what we are. And, you know, 10 years in a row, we were in the playoffs.
Right.
They can't even get back to the playoffs, not to mention 10 years in a row. And I mean that respectfully, too. It's a hard game to play, and especially dominate the game the way we did in the 70s.
Right.
And so that reason, I'm just very grateful, Coach Landry. He had a system that worked. You know, he didn't take any bull from anybody. You know, we had to be on time. We were never late. You know, wore a tie while we traveled on the planes. I mean, he just, you know, you believed in him. You had confidence. And he would get up there and he would say at the beginning of the season, my faith in Christ, my faith in God is first, my family second, and you guys come third. What? We don't want to be third. We want to be first. But when you come to your senses, as I did finally, you understand that.
Right, right. Tell me what about John Niland. What did you enjoy about playing in the NFL, about playing with the Cowboys? What were your favorite experiences that you,
well,
you enjoyed?
The first thing I enjoyed is I could kill the guy in front of me and wouldn't get indicted. And if I could hit him so hard to knock him out of a game, that was a, boy, and you're not going to hit me back? No, they hit you back. But you could just knock the guy as hard as you want and not get indicted. You could kill him, literally, and not get indicted. That, to me, was a very interesting concept. If anything, that book with Maxwell Maltz got me in a mental position of saying, I can kick his butt. I don't care how big he is. I just keep coming. I just keep coming. Just keep coming. Just keep coming. And just keep coming.
And win
and
the battle one day.
Exactly. You wear them down. You wear them down. They wear you down. You wear them down. I mean, the whole idea is that, you know, a defensive lineman can make a tough day for you.
Right.
I mean, if they really wanted to make a tough day for you. But see, they get all foggy because they got a game plan. That fogs it up a little bit. And consequently, they don't play that way all the time. But you could really make an argument that, you know, the defensive linemen really have an advantage over you. Mm-hmm. They can go the ball anyway. They can do anything they want to you.
You got to react.
And we have to hit them with the right shoulder, left shoulder, cut in front of them, do this, do that. So they're at a major advantage, and I think, and so a good defensive lineman can make you a long day on a Sunday.
Right.
Make you a long day. What kind of language is that? And so consequently, in my case, I was just lucky that I was better than the other ones because I kept coming, I kept coming, I kept coming. And I just truly believed in myself. But Landry had a lot to do with that, too. You know, he was very, there was no BS. I mean, you did your job. And if he didn't, he'd get rid of you.
Right. Well, it seemed like he had he could bring in the players to play in the right place, the right position, and train them and get them there. I mean, he could read into a player who he traded for or he drafted. He looked a little bit further into the player than what he's doing right now.
Well, again, he was the first coach. I don't know of any other coach, but he was the first one I heard that did aptitude tests for all the players. You were given the same exam that freshmen get when they go to college. Mm-hmm. You know, here's a dot, here's a square, here's a circle. What do they have in common? I don't know. But if you can figure it out, you play guard. If you couldn't figure it out, you play defense. So it's a game that you have to, it's tactical, it's very intricate, it's certain, you know, it's movement, it's art,
right.
it's all of those things. And it is a great game. It's just, I just don't believe it builds any character.
Right. Beating each other up every day. Tell me about your relations with Tom Landry as a player and as a person.
Well, as a player, I didn't get to know him. I only played for him 10 years, so I didn't get to know him. That's a joke.
Passed by in the hallway.
That's a good joke by Blaine Nye said that. I think Walt Garrison. I only played for him 12 years. I didn't get to know him very well. He wasn't a warm and fuzzy. He didn't run up and say, good game. Now, he would bring it out to your attention if you watched the films on Tuesday. And he'd go, Niland, you're all pro, but that guy across from you, last Saturday, he was all world.
He's bad.
All pro, all world, yeah, okay. Meaning you didn't play very well. So he had some humor with him, but he respected your game, I think, and he certainly expected you to play. Now, you know, again, the knowledge that he had and the way he went about it, his offense, his multiple offense at the time of the 70s and 60s when they brought it in, that was unheard of, a multiple offense. What that meant was you could run 20 plays out of the same formation.
Right.
And you could change the formation and run the same play. I mean, and you got to change up the blocking at the line of scrimmage instantaneously. And the back has to change and the fullbacks are, things have to change it. So you had to have some smart, I say smart players. Players that could really adjust at the line of scrimmage.
Right.
I don't know how smart we were, but we could adjust. And consequently, you had a team that was far ahead of its time, as Coach Landry. And look at his record. Record speaks for itself.
Right.
10 years in the playoffs.
In a row.
And they can't even get back to it. I mean, it's a shame. But that's the way the game is today. There's a lot of parity in the game, a lot of like, equal things in the game. You know, certain coaches do certain things, the other ones catch on pretty quick.
Right, right.
Especially if they have success with it. So it's a game that has not lost its luster. It's continuing to grow. There's more people watching today than ever before, but there's less kids growing up in the game than there was before.
Right.
The kids aren't playing quite as active as they used to play. Their parents are saying, no, if you don't want to play football, we don't want you to get hurt. You know, back when I played, getting hurt, no such thing. That's just part of the game. You work with the bumps and bruises. Now, today's players, they're smarter than we were. If they don't want to play, they won't play. If they want to get hurt, they won't get hurt. I don't blame them. And I do think that, as Thomas Jefferson said, it doesn't stand much character. But I understand what you're saying. It's a great game for competition. It's a great game for camaraderie. And win one for the giver and all that kind of stuff. But when it comes right down to it, it's kind of boring.
Kind of boring. But you know, at the time at your era, when you played football, because you loved the game of football.
Yes.
You know, the money wasn't there like there's the players now.
Sure.
The players now, they play for the game. Oh, they're good, but not necessarily see that they play for the love of the game. They play for the money. Because when they make enough money, then they can walk away. Yeah. But you guys, when you guys played the game, the money really wasn't there because you guys actually built the picture, built the future for these players making this money.
Yeah.
But when you played the game, you loved the game.
Well, yeah, we did. We loved it, but we got paid good too. You know, right. We can't complain. We got paid more than I thought we were worth. Quite frankly, you know, it's a game that you play and you get paid for this. I love the game. You got paid. What a concept! So I would say to you that you know the players today that it's in the stratosphere of ridiculous.
Right.
I mean, to get the kind of money they get today is just absolutely. But hey, that's the market. You go with the market.
Right.
The game has been played because television brought the game to a whole different dimension.
Okay. And okay, we're gonna take one more break, and we'll be back.
We're not even finished yet.
We got one more. Yeah, we'll be done.
Good.
And we're back with John Niland. John, earlier you talked about your faith. You're a Christian, and. Football and faith. Can you tell us a little bit about your faith, about your Christian, and about your Christian life?
There's nothing spiritual about beating each other up. I don't think there's anything spiritual about that. Well, I grew up in a church, but I didn't know God. I grew up in a church. I had no idea of grace through Christ. I grew up in a church where I was legalistically doing the things they want you to do. And then finally, went off to college and didn't have any connection spiritually at all. And then I was just big and tough, and I just could handle all of it. I could go out and play the game of football, get drafted, get a big bonus. I mean, I don't need God. You know, that was kind of the...
Right.
And I wasn't disrespectful to God so much as I didn't really know God, so how could you have any feelings towards him? You know, I'll just talk to you when I die, and we'll talk about what I did, what I didn't do, whatever. Finally, when I came to the Cowboys, Coach Landry had devotionals. Before the game, he'd bring somebody in and usually speak on a spiritual level. And, of course, we went because we wanted to get pumped up for the game. And, you know, we went to the devotionals on Sunday morning because Coach Landry called the devotional. Had speakers come in, and, gosh, if Coach Landry's going to be there, I better be there too. You know, I don't want to be conspicuous about my absence. But what he did, he made a devotional on Sunday morning that gave us the opportunity to have some spiritual leader come in and teach or speak or preach. And so I used to go, and just because of the fact I didn't want to be conspicuous by my absence, and it didn't really mean much to me at all. And I wasn't really involved in that. And
right.
Of course, he did make that speech one day about his family. His family comes second to Christ, and of course, the team comes third. And you know, I was serious. It's like, oh, you mean the football team is on third?
Right.
I want to be before that family. And I didn't know God at the time, so
right.
You know, I didn't care if he stuck somebody else there. So I didn't have any real feelings towards spiritual things. And eventually I became a Christian. 1974, I gave my life to the Lord. Very strange happenings. You can Google it. You'll find out more than it's worth. You can read it. But I got saved. And I went to Coach Landry. And because I missed practice that day. And I said, Coach, let me just go ahead. We went behind the practice field and walked down the field and around the goalpost and came back the other way. We walked around a couple of times, and he goes, I tell him the whole story about me getting saved. He goes, yes, like Paul. That was like Paul, right to Damascus. And the Lord knocked him off his horse and got his attention. That's what he did to you. Okay. Whatever you say, Coach. You know, I didn't have a clue what I was, what I did. I mean, I knew what I did. I just didn't have a clue about it. We never read the Bible. I never understood the Bible. Never got spiritual teachings that I remember. And I wasn't anything but just a saved person. And I started to become curious about what exactly did I do and how did I do it, and then baptism and all that kind of. So eventually, through some very smart individuals that I trusted, I got weaned on the spiritual things. Somebody discipled me, a few people discipled me, and I finally understood what had happened the night I got saved. And to this day, you know, I'm constantly aware of the certain grace that God has given me of telling me, hey, there's more things in life than football. And the first thing you've got to learn about is my son. Why did he come? You know, my son came to save you. You rejected him. And after you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior, then things change. And they did. I got traded the next year. Landry didn't like my performance anymore. He traded me to Philadelphia. I got hurt in Philadelphia. I was out of the game.
Wow.
I lost my position. I lost my strength, I guess you'd say. I lost my character in the game of football. You get hurt. Okay, I understand that. But I was a pretty good player. Didn't get hurt first 10 years. And then the last couple, 3 years, I got hurt. And I didn't perform as well. I couldn't say that for no other reason. You give up your body. I mean, you're going to get hurt.
Right.
You know, I sit here today. I got two fake knees. I got two fake shoulders. I've been operated on 13 different times. You give up your body. I can't run to that window. I can walk to it, but I can't run to it.
Right.
So, you know, I've given up half my life in the saving grace of God, saying at least I still have my life. I still have a life now that's filled with faith and filled with the Lord Jesus Christ, and when he comes into your life, he changes you. And for that reason, I want to become a better football player, and I could do all those physical things, but now I sit here and say, I'd just like to be a better father.
Right.
I'd rather be a better husband. I'd rather be a better businessman. And all those things come about today because I gave my life to the Lord. He's in my life, and he guides me. The Holy Spirit comes into your life and guides you through circumstances that make a whole lot better sense than they did when I wasn't a believer.
Right.
And I'm just very grateful for whatever he saved me. I didn't do anything outside of just accepting it. But when you understand what you've accepted, what you understand is he's going to come and change your life. You're living now for him. And everything I do and say and act on is certainly, hopefully, to glorify the Lord. Not to John Niland, not to the football player, not to the businessman, not even to the husband. It's to glorify the Lord in everything I do. And if that comes across that way, then so be it. That's what I want.
Right.
And, you know, I'm still a sinner. I mean, I love sin. We all love sin. I make mistakes. You make mistakes. Well, but he's died to those things. And I'm thinking, where's the sanity to all of that? It doesn't make sense. You know, I don't deserve it. I don't deserve any of this salvation. But I believe it.
Right.
And he said it. I believe it. I didn't earn it. I can't earn it. And I can't lose it. What better way of knowing that someone loves you that much to give his life?
To give his life for, exactly.
That makes sense.
Amen, exactly. And going back to when you went to the Eagles and you discovered the Lord. Because Lord, God wants you. He's going to let you know if he wants you, because you're his child. And he's going to want you. And it's God's timing. When you went to the Eagles, he knew that you only had a couple years. You know, probably before you, had in your football career.
Right.
And so he wanted you. So he put you in his heart, and you got involved with him. So now, when you got out of football, he's carried you. Yeah. You've looked towards him for advice, for leadership. And now, in return, what you're doing now, which I've seen on YouTube, on the internet, I just got to watching you give a presentation to a bunch of men that were salesmen. Mm-hmm. And the Lord, how the Lord has brought you through your things and made you the best that you can be. And now you're spreading the word of Lord, of God, to these salesmen. Mm-hmm. Why are you here? Why are you salesmen? Why do we do the things we do? So for you to excel in spreading the word of God to the people that are out here that are listening and watching, and even the friends that you can come and communicate with, mm-hmm. and God bless you, because we need that in society today. And what a better example of a person that has accepted, that's been in the limelight, and is actually true to his faith and what he says, what he believes he's saying, and it's the truth.
Yeah. Well, I think football is counterproductive in a certain way. I mentioned jokingly earlier that to me, I don't think it stamps much character in the minds of men. It does have a team effort. There is camaraderie. There is that fellowship. But really, when you're beating up on each other in that pit, I'm talking about from tackle to tackle, that is a war. That's down there in the pit, and you're killing each other. You're hurting each other. You're maiming each other. You're trying to put them out of the game. I mean, at least for that game.
Right.
I'm not sure that builds any character. I don't sense that there's importance. I mean, if you're 350 pounds, that's one thing. If you're 450 pounds, that's a bigger thing. I mean, it doesn't really make sense. You know, these guys today, they're just enormously big and fast and strong. Where do we go from here? I mean, what's the point? And granted, I think there's an art to the game. There's certainly statistics to the game, strategy. I mean, that sort of thing is very, very valuable for a person who's growing up, especially the camaraderie and the teamwork and the, you know, win one for the giver type thing. And I think you kind of learn that either in sport or in school or in your Boy Scout or Cub Scout. You've got to learn that somewhere.
Right.
And I think that's important to learn. But if it wasn't for women, there'd be no football.
For no football?
If it wasn't for women, there'd be no. Who wants to play out in a dirty, full field? Oh, there's the cheerleaders over there. Okay. The stands are full. Yeah, I'll play.
You want to play and impress that cheerleader? Right?
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. And that's why I played. I remember how about you. That's why I played. I'm not kidding. I mean, that's really kind of what we played because everyone kind of looks up to it, you know. And you get a date on a Friday night and went to school and you play football. Yeah, I said, yeah. But she said, what position do you play? I said, drawback. So it turns out that the game is what it is.
Right.
Now, listen, we're not going to. But the game is losing its luster. I think within 10 years, you will not recognize the game.
I agree with you. I think it's going
to a blood sport. I think it's going to the MMA, mixed martial arts, killing each other, you know, hurting each other, tapping out, whatever they call that thing.
The longevity is going to be gone.
Well, I think it's going to go to a blood sport. I think we'll go back to Gladiator. You'll see I think within 10 years, you might see Gladiator out there and legally kill each other and see the blood, because we love blood.
That's what society wants to see.
Yeah, we're bloodthirsty people. We want to, you know, we drive down the road, see an accident. You know, what happened to that person? We want to see blood. And when you put it on television, that's going to really be good. If you're watching the Super Bowl over here and Gladiator over here, full Gladiator, what are you going to be watching?
Gladiator.
You'll be turning a dial.
More violence, yeah.
So I hope it doesn't happen because I think that's a degenerate thought process for our society. But I think it will happen. Something like that's going to happen. I mean, it may not be exactly what we see today. And I think football, in my opinion, is on the downhill slide.
It appears to be.
Yeah, I mean, it's making money. I mean, right. It's on the uphill slide as far as viewership and people that are watching it and buying the soap suds and stuff like that, the commercials. But really what it boils down to is I think that there's other things out there that kids today growing up are more interested in
right. Than
just getting beat up on a Saturday.
Well, I mean, now they see examples of players. And it's like yourself, I mean, your body's been reconditioned now
yeah. Since
playing, you know, giving your life to the What's game. John Niland doing today? What's John Niland doing as...
Well, when you leave, I'm going to walk the dogs. I like my home life. I just enjoy... My wife paints. You probably get some paints. I'll show you some stuff around here that she's done. And she's a great painter. I like working, and I stay active. I work for a concrete company. You know, those big ready-mix trucks to go down the road.
Right.
We're taxi service for concrete. And I've been working for them for a couple of years as sales. I love it. You know, it's really great to see that you can take concrete and make it. You can make that chair out of concrete. You can make this table out of concrete. You can make this room out of concrete. I mean, it's the greatest building product in the world, and we make everything. Well, we just provide the concrete. We don't make chairs or anything. But we mix the mud, they call it, and we get it to the delivery location and get back to them and get some more. But I take my wife out and I go, hey, honey, that's our concrete. We built that building over there. We didn't build it, but yeah, that's our concrete. That's the road. We built that road out there. I mean, it's really kind of enjoyable to see how much concrete is. I mean, you look at the pyramids. They're still standing up.
Right.
That's concrete.
Right.
You know, and concrete is not just one thought. When most people think of concrete, they think of concrete. But there's multiple styles and designs and textures of concrete. It's like making a cake.
Right.
And you can make it... as creative as you want to be in the way of a style and look and color and texture. And that's what makes it interesting. But I work in sales for Nelson Brothers Concrete. Our home office is in Louisville. And the commercial is, we're also at Prosper.
There you go.
Also at Anna. We're also in Aubrey. So, no, we have about 100 trucks that deliver concrete every day. And I enjoy it. I'm in sales. I like selling. I like creating things.
Right.
I like building things. I like seeing things that that you design with your hand. And voila, it's a house. You know,
right.
Well, amazing to me.
You're kind of like the artist, supplying the artist for what they need to build their picture, yeah.
I studied art in school. I still do artwork. Well, I don't do as much as I do it, but there's a few paintings around here. I did my wife's painting, and I've done a lot of things with my hands, because I really like working with my hands, and I'm not that good with woodwork, but I like to paint. My wife paints. Our hobbies are basically going to Walmart and buying more paint.
So you've been doing this how many years?
I've been in the chemical. I was in the chemical business for 30 years, meaning I worked for a company that we sold chemicals to clean equipment, clean the store, clean your house. That's right. And then I got with this concrete company about 2 years ago. Every 30 years I change jobs.
I'm going to one more question, and I got a little final thoughts. What advice have you got for players coming up? Any like in football, baseball, sports? What kind of advice have you got for them growing into the sport field?
Well, if you're a football player coming up, first of all, take some courses in economics. Learn where money comes from and how it's invested and where it's going. Understand what money does. Money is going to be the thing that you're going to be judged by when you retire. Not that you have to have money, but you've got to have some investments because you're not going to have time to look into these things playing football. Football
right.
will absorb all of your emotional energy. In the off-season, you'll just try to get your body well again. You know, and you'll be busy doing other promotions or whatnot. So, you know, learn the economics of football. Go to work, get a job. Most guys today don't need a job. I mean, they're making $20 million a year, and they play 5 years. Do they need a job? I mean, job-wise, money-wise, no.
Right, no.
But keep something in the back of your mind that you would like to do, because really what the Lord wants us to do is to love our neighbor.
Right.
Like you love yourself. Oh, that's hard. And to treat people like they want to be treated. And for that reason, you got to learn more than just blocking and tackling. I mean, there's more to life than just that. And learning something that really gets you excited and wakes you up in the morning and get out there and you have interaction with people. And of course, the fans are out there too. They'll occupy a lot of your thought process. But just getting out and enjoying life with kids, family, and mothers and fathers and all the relatives that come and visit. That's life, you know.
Right.
And my wife is my greatest fan. She's perfect for me, and a wonderful, wonderful gift that God gave me that I don't deserve. I mean, she's terrific, and just to have kids and watch her as a mother and whatnot, and we do things together today that we just love doing things together that just glorify the Lord. Hopefully,
that's awesome. So there's later life after football, family, friends, your job, spreading the word of God, such as you do.
You want to have an effective ministry? Go try to witness the guy next door to you.
Yeah.
See what he says.
There you go. I got my final thoughts, which John pretty much brought up earlier. When you watch a football game, you see the long passes, you see the good runs, the long runs, the fancy runs. But what we don't see and what we don't realize is the linemen that are in the pit. These guys that John was telling about, these guys are beating each other up for letting these running backs open these holes for them to make these long gains, and for the quarterbacks to stay back there for a long period of time making these long passes. What these linemen got to do to prepare for a game, lifting weights, getting sore after games, and the running, the stamina that they've got to put up with. Every play that they get on the line, they're putting in 100%. They're beating each other up on every play. Where quarterbacks drop backs and just throw the ball, the running back runs a little bit, yes, and goes back. But these guys, the game of football is born in the trenches. And if you ever watch a football game, pay attention to the linemen. See what these guys do. They, from the very start of the play to the very end of the play, you hear a whistle. These guys are fighting each other. These guys are making these plays, opening these holes, giving time for these quarterbacks to throw the ball. These guys are what's making football is today. These are the reasons why we remember all these long passes and these great runs and these plays and the people talk about.
The unsung hero.
Exactly.
Very
unsung hero.
Yeah.
So pay attention to the game. Look at the linemen. Respect the linemen. Appreciate the linemen. Because these guys are football. This is what football
Don't watch
is.
Football. Go read a book.
But, John, I want to thank you so much for giving us the opportunity interview you. And it's been a privilege. It's been an honor. And I've learned a lot. And your faith speaks volumes to me. And I hope it speaks
volumes. And that woman behind the camera is probably your best asset. So, right?
He's my best friend. God's blessed me like you, you know, Jesus blessed you with your wife.
Yeah.
My best friend. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be the people who we are today.
We'd be a mess. We'd be a mess.
Automatically. Yeah, exactly. I hope you all enjoyed the interview. And we'll talk to you later. God bless.
Wanted a mini helmet of your favorite NFL sports team? Come visit ChapmanSports.net, where we have a wide variety of mini speed helmets, mini replica helmets, full-size helmets of your favorite NFL football teams.